I feel like I have to engage in the traditional invocation before any presentation of this sort and let you know that none of the, this is for educational purposes only, none of the opinions expressed are those of our employers, any of our customers, our clients, and in some instances, not necessarily any of our own. Additionally, any questions we may answer, and I've been told my panelists are happy to answer questions in the middle, none of their answers should be taken as legal advice, nor is it forming any sort of binding attorney-client privilege.
I'll give fashion advice if anyone needs it.
And since I'm not an attorney, whatever I say goes. Right.
So to begin with, my name is Greg Silberman. I, 9 days ago, was the chief privacy officer at Cylance. So any of you who signed up just because you wanted to hear what the chief privacy officer of Cylance had to say, tough luck. I am, however, now the deputy general counsel at Blackberry, who acquired us in the last few days. And I'm gratefully joined by people who know a lot more than I do on this subject. I have Ruby Zefo, chief privacy officer from Uber.
And Malcolm Harkins, I'm chief security and trust officer with Cylance, and been Greg's business partner for the past couple of years. And prior to that was Ruby's business partner for several years at Intel.
And so with that, additionally, for those of you who are also excited to see Theresa Payton, unfortunately, she got called away and can't be with us this afternoon, but she'll be back around, I'm sure. So with that out of the way, let's begin. Hopefully this is going to work. In Greek mythology, the labyrinth was an elaborate maze commissioned by King Midas to imprison the Minotaur. I won't go into how the Minotaur came to be. The story gets kind of gruesome for those of you who are classicists. Roll with me. Those of you who don't know it, go wiki it. Its architect, Daedalus, had so cunningly made the labyrinth that even he could barely escape it. The Minotaur was eventually slain by Theseus, son of the Athenian king, but only with the help of King Minos's daughter, Ariande, who gave him a sword to slay the beast and a spool of thread so he could find his way out. Today, the regulatory framework that we see governing personal data and information has very many ways become a modern labyrinth of Greek mythology. It's massive, it's confusing, and it's difficult to navigate even for those who create it or are otherwise expert in it. Today, our panelists are going to hopefully give guidance to help all of us sort of find our way through that labyrinth.
That's how we're starting?
Yep,
hopefully.
Hopefully. It's a big task, but I am providing them with much more than a piece of thread and a sword. I'm giving them people who really do have have had real visionary experience in leading companies through this maze and continue to do so in this day. As we all are aware, companies are struggling to manage the challenge of the ever-evolving regulatory regimes, which include not just privacy and not just security, but all of the risks combined which are facing companies today. As it rapidly evolves and changes, there'll be more and more problems to address in the future. Welcome to just a tiny corner of that labyrinth. Here's a fraction of some of the regulations that are privacy focused. So what's this existing landscape look like today? Some have been around for a long time. SOX, Privacy Act of 74. Many of these are things that may or may not be relevant today. Some of them are continuing to be evolved and have a significant meaning. Some are geographic, GDPR, CCPA. Some are very sectoral, HIPAA, COPPA, FERPA. The list of abbreviations goes on and on and on. As we take a look at that, realize that, again, it's only part of the question, only part of the problem. And despite the complexity of addressing and complying with privacy and cybersecurity regulations, there is hope if you have a proper framework for looking at it and considering it and understanding what can be done. As I said, fortunately, I've brought all of you more than a spool of thread and a sword. And so with that, let's turn to the experts. Malcolm? Since this was actually supposed to be, I'll fess up, so this is gonna be a tiny bit confusing because I screwed up. I'm a dumbass. This was actually supposed to be something referred to as the bubble chart. The bubble chart, I pulled the wrong drawing. I gave the wrong diagram. This is still super effective, and I'm sure Malcolm could have covered for me, but since it's not going to be a perfect one-to-one correlation, I thought I would own my screw-up at the front end and thereby beg your forgiveness.
It's a different bubble chart. So my view of this, having worked at Intel as Chief Security and Privacy Officer for a number of years, and then as Chief Security and Trust Officer at Cylance, my framing of the information risk dynamics are one of like a kaleidoscope, like this picture. You've got the traditional infosec view of the world, but you've also got privacy. You've got business continuity, disaster recovery. You've got product security and product privacy related items. You've got other legal and regulatory compliance items. They're in essence interconnected risk issues that have to be managed in an interconnected fashion. Because if you manage them in silos, you're going to under control for the risk or over control for the risk. You're going to put people through mandatory privacy training and then on the heels of it do mandatory security training. Well, why not do an integrated training program with them, right? And so when I look at these things, and that's why for me the security and privacy things are bound together. They're slightly different lenses, but you need them both to be join together and work together in order to manage appropriately not only the legal compliance aspects to navigate the labyrinth, but also the other risk dynamics of the threat actors and threat agents. So the intent of this thing was to open everybody's view that these are interconnected risks, and we need to manage them that way in order to really achieve the right level of privacy and achieve the right level of risk management.
So as you can see, as we're starting to look at this and recognizing that that wall of text I showed you earlier of the various privacy regulations, we now have to address this in context of all of the other risks that are facing a company. I know, Ruby, you have a tremendous amount of experience in sort of integrating this into sort of the practices of large organizations. How do you, in looking at this tremendous volume, how do you manage the risks created by, you know, the need to comply with privacy? How do you bring that into the rest of the organization as far as evaluating what needs to be properly addressed? And I just blew the question
to you.
All right,
I'm going
to
answer the question that you should have asked. So when I look at the slide he had before this one, I think, holy crap, look at all those laws. And particularly, even if you're just a US-based firm, but particularly if you're an international firm, how do you run the gauntlet of all these different laws? That's the question I would want to know, because it's extremely complicated now. And some of the challenges that I've seen are several-fold. So first of all, if you're looking at things through US eyes only, that's a mistake. Because even if you were hoping you could avoid that four-letter word, GDPR, let's just take a show of hands. I want to make sure everyone knows what I'm talking about. Who knows at least a little bit about what the GDPR is? I would think almost everyone, because it's so ubiquitous. Okay, so it's the European General Data Protection Regulation that came into effect last year. And you may say to yourself, that doesn't affect me. I'm here in the US. Well, first of all, if you're just serving any kind of person in the EU, it does affect you. You don't even need to have an establishment there. But wait, there's more. If you are here in California, you've probably heard of the California Consumer Protection Act. That one has GDPR elements in it. Oh wait, you're from Washington State? Go look at what they just announced as a bill that's quickly racing through its process. Brazil, yes, India, kind of. So if you're wondering where this is going, it's going forward to a much more privacy protective regime. So if you were the type of person that has been thinking, what could I get away with all this time? Now you have to start thinking about what should I do, not what can I do, because that's where the world is going when it comes to data. So I think the best way to start is with principles. I just announced internally at Intel some privacy principles, largely based on public ones called the Fair Information Practice Principles that have been around forever. They were started in the 1970s right here in the good old USA. They've stood the test of time. They've formed the basis for many international laws, including the GDPR, and have been adopted by economic organizations and others. Pretty good place to start. So if you're unclear, let's say you have a new technology and you're like, well, it's not specifically regulated. Maybe I'm doing something with AI. Principles, good place to start. Not sure where to land? How you're viewing your approach to data is very important. So having the mind share that I'm going to do what the customer wants is a really good place to start instead of, I just want to gather all the data I can and see how I can use it.
Yeah, and I think that leads into another subject we were discussing earlier, the idea of data hoarding. Companies that are collecting massive troves of data that they're not even entirely certain all the time what they're going to do with it. I know from my...
And many of them are the vendors on the floor that are siphoning up the data from your systems and endpoints, not knowing exactly what they're going to do with it.
They have some analytic that they want to run against it. They have some tool they'll use against it. But we'll take it all now, look at it, and then maybe there's some unintended utility or some ability to process it later that we'll discover, particularly as we see a greater rise in artificial intelligence and people are going, oh, well, this is all good training data. We'll just use all of this for this purpose. And the fact is that they're not thinking through what the potential implications of that data collection are. And this is something I think you were telling me earlier, we're seeing more and more of the European regulators and even regulators in the United States starting to recognize that this is a problem that needs to be addressed.
Right. There are a couple of interesting cases. I mean, the one against Google is largely about the lack of transparency. I honestly think this is the biggest problem that we have in data privacy right now, is people not understanding what's happening with their data. And there have been people, like there's the French Data Protection Authority was, you know, collaborating with a company that would have gotten a fine had they not played nicely in the sandbox about their data protection practices. And they were an ad tech company that was giving geolocation information to ad targeters. And they came up with a banner that would be shown on the advertiser's site that said, look, if you opt, this is a free service. If you opt in, here's how we're going to use your data. It's to provide ads for you that we think you would actually like, and that's why the service is free. And they got a pretty big uptake in people who were willing to do that. It's the not understanding that people don't like, and Google got fined because it was very hard to figure out what was happening and very hard to opt out. You had to go through multiple clicks and steps to figure it out, and it was very difficult. And then in Germany, there's an interesting one against Facebook. It's an antitrust case. It's from the Competition Authority. But it's based on GDPR. It's the fact that they're gathering all this data and creating profiles on you from the different types of services they have, right? So the Facebook app and WhatsApp. And they decided that that was anti-competitive behavior because of their position in the market, but used data privacy and protection as the bootstrap to get the anti-competition decision. So you can see that this is something that's going to continue happening to the data hoarders, which is, what are you doing with the data? Why do you need it? It's not okay not to tell people what's happening, and you need to be more transparent and make it easier for people to have choice.
Comment on that, Malcolm?
Yeah, you know, the other aspect of it from my vantage point is it's one of the data flows and the technology architectures, because you might actually think you know you're doing the right things with the data, and you might have the principles and the practice and stuff, but as people have access to the data, they come up with new usage models. They come up with, hey, I'm going to analyze it this way. I'm going to use it a different way. I'm going to extract this information over here and combine it with that information over there. And so, which gets back to principles and really kind of codifying that, because it's easier to train your staffs in your organization on principles than policies, because policy documents, what, they're 100 pages or something, right? You can get principles, think of them, you know, like the Ten Commandments, thou shall and thou shall not, and make them pretty crisp and clear, because you'll get your organizations to be directionally correct. The other aspect of it that Greg and I've implemented, Ruby and I, we did similar things and different things at Intel, is for certain aspects of individuals that have sensitive roles that have access to that personal information, is also codify a code of conduct that's specific to that job. That's in essence a set of ethical guidelines, because that also then is a contract with that employee. Here's how I'm going to conduct myself with the usage of this information, and what insights I gain, what I might do with them. And those things, I think, are really great grounding for creating the right culture around privacy.
And that combines with just making sure that it's something that throughout the organization, people understand the import of this. I used to be an attorney in private practice, and I'd see clients come to me, and the engineering group would have developed something, and it finally bubbles up to legal, and then the question comes, can we do this? Is this legal? Is this lawful? And it might be really sort of fascinating technology, but some of this was really along the lines of, hey, hold my beer, look what I can do. And it was somewhat terrifying that this was right up against the edge of becoming a feature within a product or being functionality within the product. They were wanting to know, do we have to tell our customers about this? As opposed to, I know in your organization, you actually have engineers, which, you know, they want to compete for you. They seem to be competing with you for the role of, well, we're privacy as well.
Can I am very lucky, yeah. So, first of all, it does take a village. I don't see myself as the only privacy, you know, lead at Uber at all. I need to work with the engineers. I work with the CISO every single week. I work with the privacy product people. I'm super lucky that they feel like they own it just as much as I do. I've never worked at a place where someone was fighting over things like, who gets the privacy alias? And I'm like, I'm the CPO, I get the alias. But the fact that someone's arguing with me about it is awesome. So the great things that they bring to the table are I have back-end people who are working on the platform and how to make things great, you know, with how we're using the data there. But my favorite is the group that does the privacy products. They're the ones who look at the app and say, what do people want in here? What do they not want in here? What would make a better user experience? And that's, like, they come to me with these ideas, right? I'm like, look, I'm happy to help, but you guys are the geniuses on, you know, using the data from the data scientists and stuff on how people interact and what they want. So that's really where I believe a competitive advantage comes from. It's how the person's actually experiencing your product or service, not so much, you know, what you proclaim in the New York Times that you stand for, but how you instantiate that down in the customer's experience.
Just looking out, show of hands, anyone out there actually make a decision as to what product they use based upon the privacy stance of the company?
Few people.
How about if you see a company using your data in a way you find obnoxious? You're going to stop using it, right? Much. Yeah, all the hands come up. So recognizing that for organizations, it may not be a immediate competitive advantage where somebody.
You're going to take my idea. I just told you.
No, I'm just restating
over
it.
Tea.
Oh, well, yes, of course I am. My God. Well, actually, no, I'm going to ask you to share it, but you were talking. I didn't want you to think I was trying to just lean on you for this. So
here's what I said. He asked me if I thought it was really a competitive advantage, if privacy was really a competitive advantage, and I said I needed to unpack it. Because you have Tim Cook, God bless him, out there saying privacy counts, you know, it's really important to Apple. And then I said, but have all these Android users switched over to Apple because of it? Probably not. They care about what they're getting in their experience beyond just privacy. So I think the only way to answer the question is to say, how have you brought that down into the features of your product so that they like what they're experiencing? Even if they're not actually viewing it as a privacy feature, they just like what's happening, right? So if you're in the Uber app, for example, you don't have to give us your geolocation. You can turn it off, just go to a corner if that makes you happy. If you want to chat with your driver, you can have in-app chat. You don't need to give him your phone number or contact information. We did that so that customers would like using the app. I love it because I'm a privacy professional. But if it gives me a competitive advantage over someone doing things differently, that's great. And they may not tie that to, you know, oh, that's Uber's privacy stance, even though behind the scenes it is.
Yeah.
Hey, just since the show of hands was kind of low in terms of using privacy as a decision-making tool for things, I mean, there's obviously the consumer context with Android or Apple and Uber or not. But since we are at a security conference, I would request that all of you make sure you do a privacy impact analysis of the security technologies that you have in your environment. You will see dramatic difference. And if you're a security professional, privacy is an information risk, and it should be a part of your job. And you should weigh that into whether or not that tool is the right tool, or that process is the right process, or that service is the right service. And I see too frequently, particularly at the security conferences, where the security swings and honestly doesn't give a crap about the privacy side of it. And we've got to make sure that those things are done in conjunction. So if you're a privacy person, be a pain in the ass and make sure your security team does a privacy impact analysis, or go do it for them. If you're a security person, go grab your privacy partner and have them go do a privacy impact analysis of your security tools and processes and approach.
So with that, do you have any other suggestions for working with your, you as a CISO, do you have any, what other suggestions do you have for your CPO, since I no longer have to suffer that?
Considering I was a CPO for a while when I was at Intel. My view of this is, and we were chatting about this and joking about it earlier, because Greg had asked, and I said, well, when I was at Intel, Ruby was kind of like my work wife. We were, in essence, partners. You couldn't go to mom.
He still and can't
dad.
Quit me.
Exactly. You couldn't go to mom or dad and get a different answer, right? And sometimes we would disagree in front of the children, but we figured out how to agree on things. Or I would go, you know what? You've heard my opinion, but you're the expert in this space. It's your decision, because it's really codified from a legal perspective. Other times, it'd be the operational implications of the risk dynamics. And Greg and I have a similar relationship at Cylance.
It's a bromance.
Yeah, bromance. But I looked at it as
he's ashamed.
As a partnership. I mean, they're inextricably linked. You can't separate them. Some folks have heard me say this before. Security and privacy are like two magnets. When turned one way, they're perfectly binding, because you need good security to achieve privacy. But if security goes too far, it doesn't understand the nuances, and I've said at this conference many times, most of the security professionals out there, and most of them on the floor out there, are colorblind and tone deaf to privacy. They only think that if you have good security, you therefore have privacy, and that is not true. And so when that happens, it's like turning the magnet. Or when the privacy side can stay too academic, too ethereal, too, you know, not grounded in how to codify it technically, it's also turning the magnet. What happens when you do that? The magnets then polarize. And I think we've had a polarization of security and privacy, and it's up to both the privacy professionals and the security professionals to recognize we can't be polarized. We have to design these things together. And it drives me nuts when I hear people talk about, well, it's a balancing act. Well, the balancing act in a security side always says the security wins and privacy loses, rather than say, how do I design them together and optimize them together? So I'll get off my soapbox.
Can I pile on to that? So honestly, if you look forward, you have to learn about the other, I don't like to call them sides, the other practice. You're not going to be a good privacy lawyer if you know nothing about the security function. In fact, I have a person doing both in the back of the room here. And you're not going to be a very good security person if you know nothing about privacy. I mean, just look at the paper. I mean, if you look at the latest news headlines on these issues, it's kind of stopped being data breach. I mean, something will come along, but everybody's kind of getting a little bit exhausted with that. And the newer topic is what people are doing with the data. How are you, like Cambridge Analytica, there was no breach there. It was how you're collecting and sharing the information and scraping the data of friends who had no idea it was happening. There was no breach in that analysis. And that's what a lot of the headlines are about. They're pure privacy plays on what you're doing, how you're collecting it, who you're sharing with it, and where it ends up.
Yeah, well, and the other aspect for me, again, widening it out besides just privacy, for me, the notion of data breach goes beyond just the legal definition of privacy. And I think if you think of publicly traded companies, the SEC has done this over and over again, but most companies are failing to live up to their Sarbanes-Oxley and SEC responsibilities of publicly disclosing to their shareholders where they've had a breach of their systems that is a potential material or significant consequence of either intellectual property or a material degradation of system controls that could lead to an outage and have a material impact. Most organizations today are not disclosing to their shareholders those type of data breaches, and they should.
So beyond the examples you just gave, just to cut to the chase, biggest mistake that companies are making today?
Boy, you know, there's a lot of them. I think in many cases, the biggest mistake companies are making today is they're misperceiving risks. And they put on the risk lens of confusing accepting risk and acceptable risk. They'll think that accepting risk means it's acceptable risk, and then it's acceptable to who? And who's the risk going to impact? And I think a lot of organizations today are prioritizing their risk decisions like Lee Iacocca did when he shipped the Pinto for 7 years. They're focusing on risk to the organization and managing their liability rather than focusing on risk to their customers and the societal risk that might be created.
Ruby, do you have anything? Oh, I guess we really heard yours is the over-focusing on the United States.
I don't have just one either. What was the question exactly? What was the biggest risk?
What do you see the biggest mistake that companies are making while they think they're doing everything, you know, while they think they're doing right? What are the companies, what's the big screw up that everyone?
I don't know that there's a big screw up. I think just closing your eyes and sticking your head in the sand. I mean, global companies, for example, when GDPR came around, everyone was just like, holy crap. And a lot of people did literally nothing for a really long time and hoping it would somehow go away. And instead, what it's done is proliferated, right? It's now wending its way and spreading its wings into many other laws. So that didn't work out very well.
Just another item to add on to it, because it was a dialogue I had with the CIO recently, that it drives me nuts. Well, I manage to a risk register, right? Or, you know, I've got a business to run. Rather than saying, you know, again, risk register's calculation of risk, right? It doesn't mean that you're actually managing risk. Having a risk register doesn't mean you're managing risk. It just means you're calculating it. And you sometimes can get lost in those calculations and use them to massage the reality of the situation, because it's like a CMMI model, right? Nobody goes for CMMI 5. Everybody convinces themselves 3.5 is pretty good, and guess what? It's a path to mediocrity.
You know what else it is if it's not privileged?
It's a problem.
It's discoverable. Sorry, I'm a lawyer.
Yeah.
That's all I hear.
Discoverable data, we're moving towards that. You know, and as we look at this from the standpoint of the important thing to realize is that you can't manage just towards, the law says I have to do this, so I will do exactly that, and manage as if this was a checkbox exercise.
I would like to challenge someone to tell me what exactly that means in some of these laws. I'm still trying to figure it out.
Right, and for someone to say, we're compliant because we do what the law says. It's like, really? What do you do? Well, actually, as you just said, what do you think the law says? What do you think it requires of you? What is adequate? I mean, that is currently one of my favorite terms out of GDPR to identify is what constitutes adequate and for this audience.
It's the same as the FTC's reasonable security.
But there's other, you know, but again, taking a real example, though, and this is where I personally, and I'll go on record, might get me in trouble later, but I don't really care. But, you know, there's some times where you go, I will absolutely take a privacy risk and break privacy law if I have to, if somebody's life's at stake, right? So there's context that matters sometimes in these decisions, right?
If I'm in the emergency room
and somebody needs to break a privacy law to save my life, they better damn well do it, right? Because if they don't, because they're just following a HIPAA requirement, you know, we've also got to look at where the use and application of technology is going and the impacts on lives, and also recognize that type of contextual trade-off is starting to happen, and it needs to be okay to happen with the right people at the right time and with the right counsel, so that you can, again, make the best decision possible. And sometimes it's going to be breaking something to save something else.
And looking towards this from the standpoint of you don't want to say, it's a balancing, security or privacy. It isn't. I mean, I don't think there's anyone on this platform that's going to say, you know, all these privacy regulations, they're stifling innovation. They stifle, you know, our ability to have proper security.
Can I just say that something about that right now?
Go for it.
Okay. I hate hearing it. I worked for companies that pride themselves on innovation for most of my career. And I can tell you right now, if you start out with that idea that you're just going to develop products and to hell with privacy because it's going to stifle me, you will quickly find yourself clamping privacy controls on in a very inelegant way after the fact that won't do what I said, which is be an enjoyable experience for the user. If you're always thinking about what I'm using data here, what's the best way to do this for the user, then you're going to be on much firmer ground than if you go off on your own tangent. So it's not a long-term strategy.
Do you have any examples? Either one of you want to share? Or if not, that's fine too. But well, you can think of, I mean.
Yeah, well, there's.
Go ahead.
Yeah, so I think having gone through this multiple times before, there was a business back at Intel that Intel was planning to do for television and broadcast and stuff like that. You were going to think of the same thing. And they were going to put cameras with the TVs to figure out who's in the room and gear programming towards them and stuff like that. And of course, you know, there's a lot of coolness to that, but there's a lot of implications to it, right? What if it's a kid? What if it's an adult? How do you figure out if it's a guy with a beard? You know, but it was basically to try and use facial recognition, all that type of stuff, to gear programming mm-hmm. towards it. And it had some really cool mm-hmm. Ideas around it, but it was fraught with a bunch of, okay, there's creepiness aspects to
headlines
it.
Headlines that said creepy.
Yeah, there's privacy implications to it. And you know, we wrestled through it and the team tackled it to a large extent. But there was an initial resistance of, are you getting in the way of this business? It's like, you don't have a business if you do this wrong. Get your head out of your ass.
I didn't say that.
I did. probably just like that. And you know, but we wrestled through it and eventually worked itself out. But
yeah, and do you remember how the camera worked itself out?
I'll let you share that one.
It had a little lens cover you could close. Fancy.
A simple, but was missing from the initial design because they hadn't thought about it.
Though recognizing, of course, this was a little while ago. When was this? 10 years ago?
No.
No, 2011, 2012.
Okay, 2011, 2012.
Yeah,
the, I mean, 2 years ago,
yeah, 12 or 13 maybe, yeah.
A number of Samsung televisions were released with smart televisions that had a camera, faced out, default setting, on. Default was to image the room, default was the microphones were on, and best of luck to you to finding that setting. Hopefully you got one that came with a physical manual so you could look up where those settings might be, otherwise you had to go onto the internet. First, you actually had to realize that this was happening, read a news story about it, then go onto the internet, find the manual for the television you purchased until eventually some privacy supporter actually wrote a guide on how to deactivate this. But until that was present, it was a functionality that was there. They hadn't really built up the functionality around it. They had just rolled it out with the intention of, oh, this will be this awesome feature. But as with the earlier Intel set-top box, yes, there's a lot of great potential, but you have to take, going back to what Ruby said at the very beginning, you have to think about what's going to be good for your customer. You have to put your customer out there first and think about how are they going to react to this?
And you have to invest in not only the legal acumen and the policy acumen, you have to invest in privacy engineering.
Yep.
It is a technical discipline that supports the aspect of law. And I think too frequently, organizations, you know, the privacy organization is up under legal and it's a bunch of lawyers. But you don't have the grounding in the web design, you don't have the grounding in the code, you don't have the grounding in the data science. It's why I was lucky enough, you know, working with Ruby at Intel and Greg at Cylance, that we recognize, again, the technology aspects of it in addition to the policy and legal grounding that you have to have.
So continuing on from that, What are your suggestions to organizations out there that maybe don't have a Ruby or a Malcolm, that haven't, you know, become organized and thought about privacy in this way? They are still growing, they're developing product and functionality. What do you think, what do you see as sort of the necessary roles? They have, you know, a CTO, a CIO, but they don't have privacy or security imbued yet.
Yeah, there are plenty of practitioners now. In the early days, it was harder to find, and sometimes it charged a lot because there weren't so many, but there are a lot of really good practitioners that just charge you on a per project or an hourly basis. Just go get some help.
And where do you see as the most important areas? Do you have actually anywhere that you see as the most important areas for companies to focus on? Like, would it be, how would you pick? How do I pick between GDPR or, I'm here in California, CalCPA?
The data. So, you know, how much data, what's it for, where are your customers? I mean, you know, there's no magic here. Like, I get a lot of questions, for example, about different devices. You know, what would you do with it? You know, what are you doing with autonomous cars? You know, and then I remember when Google Glass came out, what are you doing with Google Glass? What if it's in the office? And I said, did you know cell phones have cameras on them? And they're all over the office. So I try to break things down to their common element, right? So if you're worried about cameras, then look at everything that has a camera and have an audiovisual policy around it. So you have to figure out your business risk. And so there isn't one answer. You have to look at where, follow the data.
And I think a lot of this goes back to understanding what data do you have as a company? What data are you collecting about your customers? How are you processing? What are you using it for? And if people were to understand what you were doing with that data, is there a problem? Is someone going to be unpleasantly surprised at how you've decided to collect? And then for the security, how about how you've decided to store this data? Does it just sit unencrypted on a server somewhere with open public access? I mean, that'd be horrifying. You know, to many in the room, that, you know, the concept would be horrifying.
Or emailed around in an unprotected format out to hundreds or thousands of people.
And probably storing a lot. Well, that's one way to get to your CIO, is explain all the dark data and all the storage costs they're incurring by not mapping the data and figuring out what's out there and storing things more efficiently that you need, so you have better data availability just for business decisions.
And just making it possible for you to actually respond to these regulatory inquiries at some point. You know, GDPR has requirements that you maintain records of data processing. The new California law will have requirements that you maintain records of data processing. I guarantee you, when we see it, Washington State and many of the other state legislations are likely to be taking up these concepts. So while you can't say, oh, I'm GDPR compliant, hooray, I've met this high watermark, I'm done, the preparation that you do and the change in your thought and learning about how you address that, I think is going to go a long way to prepare you for addressing other privacy regulations and other security regulations, because you will have understood what you're doing. And I think that's probably, in my opinion, as far as developing how you're going to have a privacy compliance and security compliance framework, it's the know thyself, know what data you're collecting, know what you're processing, so you can at least start to answer the question. Because if you don't know what data you have and where you put it, how the hell are you going to answer any of the questions or meet any of the requirements of this?
And can I say something else? Because someone asked me this yesterday. When are you done? You know, do you think you're moving into maintenance mode now? I'm like, the day we move into maintenance mode is the day we stop innovating. I mean, if you're innovating and you're using new technologies, if you're expanding, even just if you're expanding into new areas, new geographic areas, and the laws are changing, you're not going to be done. You're not going to be done. So when GDPR came into effect last year, I finally said, look, all that's happened is the baby's been born. Now the baby's sitting in the high chair. You can't ignore the baby. It's not going to be able to feed a diaper itself. You got to pay attention to the baby. And the response I got back was, it's an ugly, ugly baby. Be that as it may grow into just a lovely adult, but it's going to need nurturing. And so, I'm sorry, it's not going to be done ever. And if it was, you'd be very unlucky indeed, because it would mean somehow your business was probably stagnating.
Either that or everyone is just given up, which has a much worse result. You know, as you know, people, some of you are my age, some of you are too young to remember, but when the year 2000 came around, the world was burning, it was all going to end, but it was a deadline. Everyone raced towards it. 2000, the next day, it's like, hey, the servers didn't burn to the ground. No blue smoke. Awesome. This isn't a race, as she's just outlined for you. This is, you know, May 25th was just the beginning.
It's a journey, not a destination.
Hackneyed as the statement may be, it is 100% true. And the idea that there's a change in perception. I mean, privacy is about securing the rights of individuals. And security, as important as it is to maintain, keep the systems up, keep them running, protect corporate data, to my mind, its primary function is to secure personal data, to protect the liberties of individuals, to protect the ability of people to make decisions about how their data is used, how, you know, and to protect them from, you know, totalitarian regime and changes, you know, to their existence that they can't control unless people are given an opportunity. If you had one, you have a final sort of soapbox push or moment, Malcolm, that you'd like to share before we let these people go?
Yeah,
or at least open it up to questions?
Yeah,
people go.
Yeah. Sorry.
Well, just one thing, though. What I've seen over and over again is a misconception around what is personally identifiable information. There's so much ignorance out there that people will codify it in, it's the driver's license, it's date of birth, it's my financial records, it's this, it's that. You know, again, I'll go back to the comment I made earlier. Your machine data that knows, you know, your keyboard strokes, knows where your geolocation is, knows what websites you went to, mashed up with other stuff. There's a lot of inferences that have personal implications on individuals. And we've got to think about it that way, because I think as we go through this journey with no finish line, if we don't start thinking about those inferences and the analytical information and how that will identify me, my behaviors, my practices, my likes and dislikes, and could be then codified in code with a bias that is discriminatory or has other implications on me, even if it was unintended. Those are the things that we need to think out about versus just dealing with what I'd say is the juvenile privacy things that we're having to deal with today that we're still struggling with. We've got to think out about that future data set and all the information in that aggregation and analysis that will occur. Because if we don't do that, we'll perpetuate the privacy risk cycle that we have today, like we've been perpetuating the security risk cycle we have today, because we have crept up to it versus get in front of it.
Okay,
mine is more touchy-feely, and it's slightly embarrassing. So when I was a young lawyer, I was just one of those people who was kind of resistant to change, I'll be honest with you. I was working at Sun Microsystems, which I loved. But, you know, I was changing a lot, and I was always like, it just irritated me. Until I read this really dumb book called Who Moved My Cheese? Okay. I know, right? But it did. It helped me change my mindset. And I just had a moment of clarity where I was like, that's me. Like, I'm this mouse going down the wrong hole all the time. And so at that point, I mean, I talk about this in more leadership type talks, how this was a revelatory moment on this dumb book about mice and cheese. But I did really change the way I approached change. And so I still see a lot of resistance from security people about this. Trust me when I say it's not going away. If you embrace it, you will have a much better experience with it than if you keep trying to fight it.
Thank you very much. Super appreciate it. So before we open up to questions, 302, what does it mean to anybody in this room? Delaware? You know, it's the one phone code for the state of Delaware, part of the original numbering plan in 1947. Anybody else? Just oh, come on, can't get a little audience participation. Oh, yes.
Section 302 surveys obviously a personal responsibility.
I am so terribly sorry that I didn't hear that.
Did you? Sarbanes-Oxley.
Sarbanes-Oxley?
Yep.
Yeah, that might be a better answer than the one I was looking for. It is the number of days, as of this moment, it is the number of days you have left until the California Consumer Privacy Act takes effect and the Labyrinth gets a little bit larger. But hopefully, with some of the insight provided by Ruby and Malcolm, you'll realize that even though this is bearing down, even though there's going to be new privacy regulations and new technologies before the end of the week, it can be dealt with. Think about the data you have, think about what your customers want, and you'll make it fine out of the Labyrinth. Before we go, if there are any questions, there are microphones.
So one question for the experts up here. Have you run into any of the privacy rules that conflicted with each other, especially in the case of deletion? There was right to be forgotten. GDPR has very detailed, law enforcement is there. I can see very easily that other areas will say that law enforcement may not apply. So have you any experience with that yet?
Yeah, it's not too typical to have conflicting provisions in the same law, except for CalCPA.
I was going to say, there was an open letter published correcting CalCPA.
Lodhar Detterman, if you want to go Google, he crafted a very careful letter about the conflicting nature of that. But mostly there are exceptions for certain things when it's the same law. So it's usually different laws that are conflicting with each other.
But yeah, in that case, let's say you have a lawsuit and you have an e-discovery and a preservation order that happens to preserve data that somebody has a right to be forgotten request on. Again, seek counsel. You're going to have to navigate that because they're going to conflict, and I think that's the reality of some of those.
Here.
Thinking especially of things like biometrics, there do seem to be some hot spots of tension between secure identity management and privacy. So not just for our organizations, but for also our governments, how do we start to reconcile those things?
It's a really good question. And at Uber, we have these issues with safety, right? And so we may want to have some kind of facial imagery for safety purposes. And for that, like take GDPR, for example, there's a proportionality test. So where's the bigger risk? And that's sort of the way it's weighed and the way that a data protection authority would weigh it, and that's the way I would weigh it. You have to take a risk-based approach and then justify why you need the data. And there are reasons why you may need that data.
Yeah, the one thing, though, is I can't change my fingerprint, right? So for me, certain aspects of biometrics, I don't actually care for because I can't change. That, and if it's digitized and gets compromised, then that digital fingerprint would be used in nefarious ways.
Sir?
So I was just wondering about maybe what's on the horizon or coming down the pipe with regards to right to be forgotten, but also, what was the other one, sorry?
Right to be remembered maybe in the future?
No, yeah, copy of all data about themselves. Forgotten. So. Not only just say a direct customer, but what about a member where you have a client and they have members, their data, or as an employee? Are there stuff that's coming down the pipeline? Because we have issues with sensitive data and change, right? And so tagging it all from a technology perspective in the first place for new input is one thing, but then legacy systems and then future-proofing.
No, I think you're right, and I think we have that issue today. Just take employee payroll, right? I don't process my own payroll. I've got a system that's called Workday, and then Workday connects to ADP, and then ADP connects to something else, right? So there is a supply chain, so to speak, of that personal data for just even a simple process called payroll, let alone all the internal handling. So that's where Ruby was talking about the data flow and knowing where it is. You get some of those requests. You have an obligation for your employees to protect that all the way through, including through those third parties.
And it's interesting you brought up right to be forgotten, because that is an area where there is unharmony and debate, because here in the US we have the First Amendment and we want to have these things public, and we don't want them particularly forgotten.
Are you aware of a good mapping of the different rules and regulations that are out there to a common, sort of least common denominator, most stringent control framework? We try to do this all the time.
Yeah, there is no one. Look, you saw the slide, right? Usually it's a 2x2, right? So you can easily find GDPR and CCPA, for example, right? California CPA. So it's usually that kind of analysis, maybe a 3 But it's not everything.
Yeah.
And you'll sometimes see like GRC tools that'll do comparison mappings down a row, but they tend to do much better with comparing, you know, ISO 27001 requirements to some other standard as opposed to looking at, you know, CalCPA versus HIPAA versus GDPR versus all of these other things. And then someone earlier had asked a question about conflicting. I mean, you know, we finally have 50 state data breach notice acts, and the humorous thing is they pull in different directions to a degree that, you know, there's an entire cottage industry that built up around basically just sending out the form letter that says, oh, we screwed up again, and, you know, there's been a breach, and we're providing you this required notice. But because one state requires them to disclose certain information and another state prohibits a different one, it's just basically turned into this.
There are tools, though, where that just summarize by jurisdiction what the privacy laws are.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, I'm aware of, like, technical control mappings. There are quite a few out there. Yeah, and you would think they'd be the same or similar for the conflicting and or comparable privacy laws.
Well, actually, on that, you can find them usually mapped to OECD and then layer those. I've not found a regulation-to-regulation one, but all of them map to OECD and then just do a copy and paste of the columns. It's been pretty easy.
Unfortunately, I think I've been flagged. I got one last question, and it's yours.
Yes, I'm just curious because it's not the first time that I hear about the camera on the TV. Who the heck makes that decision in the company? Where's common sense to begin with?
The chief product officer generally makes those decisions. But this is where I think, again, if you have the right governance framework, and governance is all about decision making. And you allow the engineers and the product officers to make product decisions, but the security officers and the privacy officers have a say and have a veto authority around the approach to the implementation of the technology. That is the right way to do it to mitigate, frankly, the stupidity of putting some things in devices that need more conscious thought.
And it also goes towards the benefit of building a culture where it's recognized by the, as you have at Uber, where it's recognized by the engineers, by the people who are building the products, designing the products, so the next generation comes out, where you don't have to give everybody a package of stickers to cover up the lens because, oops, you forgot. And with that, thank you very much.
Thank you. Thanks for coming.
Don't forget to sign out if you're from New York, or sign in if you're from one of the other states.